Pastor Miguel Gomez Acosta serves as the ELCA Director for Evangelical Mission. Please welcome him.
Yay!
Pastor Miguel has a BA in Biblical Studies from the Lutheran Bible Institute of Seattle and an MDiv from Fuller Theological Seminary. He served as a parish pastor for 10 years as a mission developer and a redeveloper before being called to the Grand Canyon Synod of the ELCA as Director for Evangelical Mission, where he served for 7 years. Last night at dinner, he commented that he does not miss being on a synod staff preparing for a synod assembly. Today, he serves as the Senior Director for New Ministry Development and Evangelism for the ELCA. Pastor Miguel is an evangelist and a missionary at heart. He also lives this out as a coach for missional pastors and congregations. He is an ICF Associate Certified Coach with over 150 coaching hours for both individuals and teams. Pastor Miguel resides in Chandler, Arizona with his wife and two young adult children. He took his son to Japan earlier this year, and when my niece saw me liking the posts on Facebook page, said, "My niece, you've never taken me to Japan." So, Pastor, you were with us at CRE, and we are thrilled to have you back today.
Thank
you. To bring us to opening the gospel, opening God's story for all of us.
Thank you so much. What a joy it is to be with you here again today. Once again, I'm Pastor Miguel Gomez Acosta, Senior Director for New Ministry Development and Evangelism for the ELCA, which is just a really long title to say I'm the evangelism guy for the ELCA. I don't know why they just say that, but of course we like long titles. I also have the privilege of having to draw on the short stick for this particular time slot to speak because obviously we're all tired. And I get that it's after lunch, it's kind of towards the end of the day and it's tiring, but it is what it is. And so we make what we do. And so I'm excited to be with you here today to be able to do a continuation of our conversation that we started at CRE. At CRE, I had the privilege of meeting many of you as we gathered together around a congregation of resources. And my talk there was on stating the case for why evangelism is not necessarily dead, but instead evangelism should be something that we should continue to be a part of our church and our tradition moving forward. And I gave, or I tried to give a case of the reasons why that was necessary for us to do that. So that was the why and the reason for it. And then I was asked that for today, I addressed the how. For you see, there is no other topic in the church more controversial and more anxiety-producing than evangelism. And I get it. I understand that it's difficult sometimes for us to want to talk to the stranger, talk to the neighbor, but the reality is that it's still a part of our call. And it is not a negotiation, it is not a optional situation, but that is part of who we are. As Jesus said, go and make disciples, did not say, go, keep it to yourself. And if your neighbor asks you, then you may answer, but instead is go and make disciples of all nations. Also in our baptism, when we are to be the light of Christ, so that all may see our good deeds and glorify our Father in heaven, for all to be able to see God's goodness and desire something, a relationship with our Father in heaven, and of course with God, and everything that we do so that the church can continue to grow, and relationship with our divine parent can continue to grow in others as well. Like Bishop said, I was 10 years in the parent and parish ministry, 7 of which was as a mission developer, which meant that I started a Spanish-speaking congregation in Mesa, Arizona. I never felt called when I first started seminary. I never thought that I was actually going to be a mission developer, or B, end up back in the Latino community. Because I had tried to kind of, I didn't want to be pegged in that kind of situation, and I wanted to do something different. So I was very set that I was gonna, you know, hell or high water, I was going to be a pastor of a white congregation someday, and that was that. You weren't gonna make me be just a Latino pastor. That was not just gonna be me. And where does it, you know, with God's sixth sense of humor, where do I end up first? But in a Spanish-speaking congregation. And not only that, but that I was going to start it. So by the grace of God, it took me a little bit, but after a while, we at the height of that ministry, we're worshiping 105 people a Sunday, which was a wonderful joy to be a part of a more progressive witness within the Latino community in Mesa, Arizona. And it was there that I learned a lot of what it meant to be an evangelist and what it meant to be a missionary, but then also to then 3 years later, for the next 3 years after that, be the mission redeveloper for a 75-year-old congregation that was also, you know, that was started, but that became, eventually became a bilingual church. But it was a 75-year congregation that was trying to grapple with and deal with, well, how do we change or how do we become different now that, you know, we've been here 75 years, but we're also dying at the same time. And of course, the experience of being able to be a part of that and the joy to be able to walk with people, within, with congregation members along the way, as through their questions as well as through our experimenting together, I was blessed to be able to witness many of God's amazing work in the world and being able to see people's lives be transformed. So that is a little bit of my story. Then becoming eventually the director for Evangelical Mission, like you have your director for Evangelical Mission, Pastor Josh Evener, who at this moment, I just thought about this, I think it's the Holy Spirit moment, I would like to pray for him right now and for his family, for tomorrow they're laid to rest his mom. So can we pray? A moment of privilege. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we praise you for Josh's mom's life and her witness to your world. We pray, Lord, as the Evener family gathers this evening and then tomorrow to raise to let rest his mom, that you strengthen that family, hold them in your arms, and that they know that you love them and that she rests eternally in your arms. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you for the opportunity to be able to pray for that family as they mourn the loss of their mother. So as part of being, especially through that redevelopment, one of the things that I focused on or that kind of didn't really come up with, but I was trying to figure out, well, what's the best way for me, at least for me, to be able to do evangelism work. For you see, I am a recovering Pentecostal. And that being said, that means that I have a very distorted reason for why we do evangelism, right? Originally. And that is, that was my formative years as a child. I was in Mexico. No, I was not Catholic. I was Pentecostal. And so, but having grown up there, the reason we did evangelism was because it was part of our good deeds, right? We did this and we wanted to ensure that we put as many notches in our belt to ensure that how many souls we brought to Jesus. But of course, now as a Lutheran, I know that's not the case because it is not what we do, but it is what the Holy Spirit does. And our calling as evangelists is not one of proselytizing. It's not one of winning souls for Jesus, but is merely to be the sowers of seeds that is up to the Holy Spirit then to grow and to grow and to be able to, the Holy Spirit then lead people to faith, that it's not our job, but our job is merely to plant the seed. And so as I was going on my journey of trying to figure out the best way for me to explain this, how I was able to do some of that work, especially during the redevelopment, the development was one thing, because I guess it was a new church, it was a new thing, but then to change systems in a congregation that was established was a little more difficult. But the best place that I could come up with, and I call it evangelism with a cup of water, is through the biblical narrative of the woman at the well. Can somebody put up my PowerPoint? There we go. So, next one. So, I'm not going to read the whole narrative of the woman at the well. I'm going to give the cliff note. And the cliff notes are something like this. Jesus was walking, was getting tired, so he goes to a well. And as he's getting tired and as he's resting, he sits on a well. And while he's there resting after his long journey, there's a woman that comes around noon and then to draw water from the well. And as she does that, Jesus asks her, "Could you give me a cup of water?" To which he answers, "How dare you ask me? For you know that you're a Samaritan, and that I'm a Samaritan, and you're a Jew. Not only that, but I'm a woman, you're a man, and this is not okay. So how is it that you're asking me to give you this water? This is not kosher, right?" And so Jesus says, "Well, if you knew who was asking you, you would ask me to give you water." And he says, "But you don't have a bucket. You don't have nothing to carry with, so what are you talking about?" And it is there that I love in this narrative Jesus' presence with the woman as he begins to do this wonderful work of getting to know her and getting to engage her, loving her and where she's at, and then growing in relationship with her in just that brief encounter to the point which at the end of the narrative, she is the one that becomes the evangelist. And she goes to the town and tells everyone. And then everyone insists that Jesus stay, and he stays with them for another few days so that he may teach them about the Lord, the kingdom of God. And that is the Cliff's Notes of the woman at the well, right? Jesus talking to a woman who is that he's not supposed to talk to, but at the same time understanding that there's a lot more that's happening here. And Jesus connecting with her and being able to give this message of hope and love and life to her so that she is transformed. Not only transformed, but then she goes ahead and then invites others. She becomes what in corporate language is called the net promoter. You know, I don't know if you have heard that expression, net promoter, that your best customer is the one that will tell another one about your product. That's your best advertisement, not the thousands and millions of dollars you spend on advertising, but it's your loyal customers that will tell others and convince others to come and try your product. So she becomes Jesus' net promoter, and she convinces people to come, and they engage with Jesus, and so this whole town is transformed because of Jesus. So that's the story in which the biblical narrative that I picked and that I really feel is the best way for how I have been able to do evangelism in my context, and I feel it's really a powerful way for us to consider the possibilities of how to be able to do evangelism in our context. Next, thank you. So again, what is it that we could learn? What should we learn from the woman at the well? Next. So the first lesson that we learned from this particular narrative is one, go to the people, don't expect them to come to you. Here is the problem of the way that we've been continuing to do church even to date. We have this myth or this assumption, this narrative in our mind that for some reason, anything that's holy only happens in our buildings. True or not true? Am I lying? Right? Is this not what we tell ourselves? That unless this happens in the church, nothing holy can possibly come from coming outside the church. And so what happens is that the way that we do evangelism, whether we invite others, is come to my church, right? Come to my church. That's the way we feel this evangelism. Come to my service. And you invite people to come to your church, which there's nothing wrong with that if you want to reach a certain demographic. But other demographics, they just won't buy that narrative. They won't buy into that, and they don't want to go to your church. But yet the gospel continues to grow, and the gospel continues to move. But we say the Holy Spirit moves where the Holy Spirit's going to move, right? The Holy Spirit does not ask you or me permission to where the Holy Spirit's going to be. So therefore, the Holy Spirit is going to move wherever they want, and it's not just at a church. We cannot contain God just in the church. So therefore, we go to where people are at. So the example that I have here, this is actually my home congregation in Chandler, Arizona, Holy Trinity. We have something called Monday Night Theology, which another way of calling it pub theology, which as you see the picture there, we're sitting at Fibber McGee's, our favorite watering hole in Chandler, which is an Irish pub. And so we go and we have theological discussions every Monday night at that place in front of everybody so that anybody that wants to join in can come in. And people are invited to a non-threatening, not in the church, but they can come and have experience, conversation, holy conversations about God in the pub, not at our church. And so this is one of the things. The other thing that we also do also at Fibber McGee's is we have a biannual beer and hymns. So we pick a night that we do, and that night we go, and we take over the bar, and we actually just do beer and hymns. So we have, church hymns, and then we play hymns for about 3 hours, and then people sing along as they're, drinking their Guinness or harps or whatever it is they're drinking. But it's all about being out in the community and being witnessed in public. Now, does it have to be a pub? No. It can be a coffee shop. It can be other things. But we go where people are at, right? Next. Second is also is what I call seeking the holy opportunities in the mundane. The mundane situation in which Jesus took the opportunity was at the well. For it was a custom for people to go, especially in the morning. Now, this is the I can talk about the theological difference between why is it's important to think about this woman going there at noon versus in the morning when most other women went to get for their family water. But ultimately, it was a mundane thing. It was a regular thing that you did. You would go to get water for your family. And it was that opportunity that Jesus takes to have a holy moment with this woman. Not at the synagogue, not in some mass gathering of people that are listening to him, but in a simple place where people just do their regular thing. A story that I love to tell, especially when it comes to this particular point of and thinking about this whole way, opportunities in the mundane. Years ago, especially when I was at the congregation where I was doing redevelopment work, I was, for many people know this, but I hunt. I'm a hunter. I hunt elk and javelina. Javelina, the little pig-looking things in Arizona. You go out in the desert, Anyway, but I hunt elk in the fall. I love going to sporting goods stores and just looking around and stuff for my gear. Well, there was a store that was going to be open close to the church, and there had been a sign for quite some time that said opening soon. And what I loved about it is that it looked like it was going to be a mom-and-pop shop. It wasn't going to be your Cabela's. It wasn't going to be your Bass Pro or any of these other ones. It was going to be a mom-and-pop shop. And I'm like, oh, man, I really want that, right? There's nothing better than Americana where you can go and have, shoot the breeze to people. I wanted that. And so when it was open, one time when I was driving on my way to church, I saw that finally open. Great. So during some time opportunity during the day, I went from the church back to the store, and I went in and went in to see what it was like. Well, when I went in, I met three young men under the age of 25. And these three young men, before you know, because of different experiences in our lives, we were able to connect. And that connection was all about, and simply talking about our hunting experiences, going shooting, doing all these things that we do, and just shooting the breeze with guys, right? With just four dudes talking about life. And that was it. It was that simple. There was nothing complicated about it. And so I would show up almost every week to see what else they got new in the store so I can, hide it from my wife that I bought something new, right? And all that stuff. And I would show up and stuff like that, and they would always show me the latest and greatest thing, that the new product, and that was great. But I would just get, and again, I knew them by name, and they knew me by name. Until Ash Wednesday. For in-between services, now mind you, during this time, I had seven Ash Wednesday services or ashings in that church because we served the school, we served first responders, and then we had bilingual services. And so anyway, there was seven services. So in between services, I was really tired. And so I'm like, I'm gonna go take a nap at home. But before I was driving back home, guess where I passed? I passed the store. And of course, me not thinking, just wanting to stop and just relax for a little bit, completely forgot that I was completely blacked out, right? So literally from head to toe, it was all black because it was Ash Wednesday, right? So there I go, just minding my own biz, and I go open the door, just like I usually did. I go in and say, hey guys, how's it going? And they go, holy cow, which it wasn't cow, it was another word, but hey, you're a priest. And I'm like, no, I'm like, oh crap, I said, no, I'm not a priest, I'm a Protestant pastor. I was like, what? He's like, yeah, I'm a Lutheran pastor, which one of the kids said, one of the young men said, I'm a Lutheran. I'm like, no way. And so then we started talking about the fact that he was a Lutheran. Well, evidently he is an LCMS Lutheran. And then these other young men started talking about their churches and stuff like that, and how they have been hurt by church and so on and so forth. And I'm like, so he said, so does this mean that we need to change our conversations now? It's like, what do you mean? It's like, well, now I have to be like, not cuss in front of you. Now we can't talk about girls in front of me. We can't do these things. And I'm like, dude, I'm still Miguel. Like, I'm just the regular guy. You just happen to know what my day job is, right? I'm like Batman. No, just kidding. But this is, this is just my day job. And so I said, no, nothing has changed. And one of them, I remember telling me very clearly, he's like, Miguel, he says, I know that you're a pastor and you have a church and everything, but don't ever expect me to change or anything because the church has really hurt me. And I will never go back. That was his statement. And I'm like, I will call him Chris. But I said, Chris, that is not my intent. You're just my friend. You're out of the church. There's no expectations that all of a sudden you're going to come to my church. We'll call it. It's like, we're just continue being dudes and hanging out. It's like, all right, great. Left it at that. And so sure enough, I continued going. And of course, I said, oh, yeah, everything's going to be fine. It's going to be normal. Great. The next day that I came back, I get there, and of course, I'm thinking everything will be fine, right? Here I am in shorts and a t-shirt again. I walk in with my flip-flops going into the store, and what is the first thing they tell me? One of the first things they say there was another customer in there. He says, this is the guy we're talking to you about. This is the guy we told you about, the pastor. And I'm like, oh, no, no, they're going to out me some more. So now, before you knew it, I was the unofficial chaplain to the store. And every time I gathered in that space, I literally would be like, if anybody that did not know, would then all of a sudden ask, you know, they would say, oh, this is the pastor that we told you about. And before you know it, there was questions and, you know, theological groundings. And anyway, all these things that I was like, oh, I just want to shop. Can I just shop, right? And that's all I really wanted to do. And so, but it was okay. It was an opportunity, right, in this, the mundane, to be able to have holy conversations, not in the church, but in this public space. And for me, that having been in that space, it took an opportunity, and finally, the moment where I saw an opening, and it wasn't that I was looking for an opening, but it was just a holy opportunity. Next slide, please. Is what we call looking for that moment, that holy opportunity, was when we had an opportunity to go on a young adult retreat. I was taking some young adults from Mesa, Arizona, to Pine Ridge, South Dakota, for what they call a pilgrimage of trust. A pilgrimage of trust, if you don't know what that is what the Tezé community in France does yearly. They always do it in Europe most of the time. And when it's there, they get 20,000 young people to come to this. But of course, when they do it in the New World, in the United States and South America, they don't get that many numbers. And they were doing their first one in the United States, and it was gonna be in Pine Ridge, South Dakota, right on the borderlands. And so that being said, I said, it was like, oh man, this is a great opportunity. So I said, I'm gonna take a group of young adults that was already a part of my congregation. And so I'm gonna take them. And so I go back to the store to pick up some stuff. And I said, hey guys, we're going to go on this trip to Pine, South Dakota, on this road trip. It's like, yeah, so what are you gonna do? It's like, oh, we're going to the Badlands. Say, we're gonna go camping, we're gonna drink beer, and we're gonna smoke cigars. You in? And they're like, yeah, we're in. All right, great. And of course, it said, we are going to a holy thing. Oh, whoever, the secret word there was beer and cigars. Great, that's it. That was the key, right? So I'm like, all right, and sure enough, I was true to my word. That's exactly what we did. For 3 days, on our way from Mesa, Arizona to Pine Ridge, South Dakota, what did we do? As we stopped, because we camped along the way. We couldn't afford to stay at hotels. So we drove this caravan of 3 cars. We would stop and camp, and of course, we drink beer, smoke cigars, and just shoot the breeze in the evenings, and then get up and continue driving the next day. And so they had a great time, and just because it was simple, nothing difficult, and that's just the way it was, right? Everything was fine. And as that continued on, one of the things that I noticed, if you have not experienced the Tezé community, is holy ground. The Tezé community is a community that really embraces everyone. And when I mean everyone, I mean everyone. And the brothers are there just to lead in chanting and singing and in prayer. That is it. There is no major theological discussions, mostly about being good to one another, that kind of thing, but nothing that's going to be controversial. Not only that, but they're easygoing. You can go if you want. If you don't want to go to the prayer, that is optional. So it was just an open opportunity. So as that was happening, I saw that especially Chris, which is the kid that said, I will never go to church, started going to the prayer. And I didn't say anything, right? Because it wasn't my business. It was his business. It was his journey with God, not mine. And as he began, which goes to the next thing that says that we need to love people where they are in their journey, right? Because I knew that he was in a particular journey that, again, it was not my business. It was God's business. And it was God who was going to have to deal with the situation. And so, I mean, Chris, I was like, you know, I'm not going to push you or anything. I did not. I never did. I never asked him anything. But as we were going along in this week of being in prayer and being in meditation and so on and so forth, it wasn't until the last evening where it's the kind of come to Jesus evening. They actually set a cross in the middle, and then they put light candles and stuff, and they invite people to come and kneel at the cross and to give, you know, all your burdens onto the cross. And so as we're here, we are in a hill right on the Badlands. We're in a hill, and down here is where they set up everything. And there, Chris, I am sitting here. Chris is right here, and then the other guy, his name is John, who is on the other side. And we're just chanting away, and we were just dirty. We smelled. It was camping, right? It was awesome. But that being said, one of the things that I noticed in this moment is when they got to a point of making the invitation, what I noticed as I'm praying and stuff like that, I just from the side of my eye, I see Chris's shoulder start to do this, start to kind of shake. That's when I realized that he was having a moment. He was crying. He was encountering Jesus at that moment. And then he walked down, he kneeled before the cross, and he sat there for 20 minutes, giving everything he had, all his pain that he had suffered through whatever, and he gave to Jesus at that moment. And I cry, or I feel like I'm crying, because if you have not experienced the transformative power of the gospel, this is why I do it. This is why I love being an evangelist, and I love being, because when I see people's lives change and transform, that is what it's all about. And so seeing Chris just completely give himself over to Jesus without anybody telling him or doing anything but him experiencing the Holy Spirit, that was gold right there. That was the Holy Spirit doing what the Holy Spirit does best, embracing him for who he was. He comes back up, continues to cry, and all I did was reach over, pat his back, and then let him finish, let him do his thing, right? Because he has an encounter with Jesus. Interestingly enough, when we returned back home, it would be a year later that he invited me to do his wedding. And he returned to church. He's not a Lutheran, but that's not the point. The point is he has a relationship with God, not because of me, but because he encountered Jesus in that dirt in the Badlands of South Dakota. And that's, again, the mundane, but also loving people for where they're at in their journey and not asking the questions of have you met the Lord Jesus or have you found Jesus? Like, Jesus is not lost, right? So when do we lose him? Or is Jesus your personal Lord and Savior? I'm like, I'm sorry, he's the Lord of all, right? So why are we talking about this? But it's being able to meet people where they're at, love them for who they are, and let them experience and meet us just setting up the possibility of that opportunity for it to happen. And that was an amazing experience of being able to see Chris' life transform. And to this day, he's still engaged in his church. And he recently, unfortunately, his marriage didn't last. And who was the person he called? Me. Because he wanted to hear and wanted me to pray with him as he struggled with why his marriage fell apart. But that's a different story. But this is what it's all about. Right? This is why we do what we do. Next slide, please. The other thing, the point that I love about this particular story, this narrative, is we need to love people for who they are. I love the question that Jesus asked, and this is the why where all of a sudden it becomes a little controversial when we talk about the woman at the well. When Jesus asks the woman, "Go, where is your husband?" Right? And she says, "Well, I don't have one," right? And all of a sudden, all the laundry is aired out, right? Oh, snap. All of a sudden, you know, all these things, there's a little shaming going on there. At least that's what we assume, that he's, you know, making sure that she knows that he knows all the bad things she's done. But I've come to an understanding of this particular piece of the pericope in a different way. Instead of shaming, I believe Jesus is saying, "I see you for who you are, and yet I still love you. I see you for who you are, and it doesn't matter what you've done. I love you." It is at that moment, not because her stuff was aired out, that she notices that he noticed her and she is transformed. And she all of a sudden says, "You have seen me and you know me." And it is at that moment that she is, you know, gets into this deep, you know, transformative time. And then she goes back and tells everyone what Jesus had told her about her life and how he has transformed her life. So we need to love people for where they are at. Another little story, especially when it comes to this particular topic, is when I was, going back to the story, the young adults that I had at the church that ended up going to South Dakota, that was a very eclectic group, to say the least. It was made up mostly of graduate students from ASU, from Arizona State, and then a few others from the community college, anyway, that were coming to be together. We had about 25 young adults that would gather together. And of course, what we talked about different things. And I wanted to have a service. I'm like, "Great, what kind of service do you want?" Because I wanted them to be theirs and for them to be identified with it. It's like, well, and I'm thinking, "Oh, we're going to have like Taizé music, or we're going to have prayer and praise." We want the Byzantine Rite. I'm like, "What?" I don't know if you know what the Byzantine Rite is. Greek Orthodox, that kind of style, right? The bells and smells. We want the I'm like, oh. But I said, okay, fine. So then I wore the garb and I did the bells and stuff like that, because I evidently there is a Lutheran Byzantine service because of the Greek Lutherans. Anyway, so I was able to learn that and be able to provide that for them. But as we continued to grow as a community, it became more and more apparent that there were still some who would not trust, our agenda. Why is it that we were so interested in having young adults? So one particular leader of this young adult group asked me the question. He's like, you know, you keep saying, especially at our, you know, the communion table, that all are welcome. I'm like, yeah, all are welcome. Do you really mean that? I'm like, of course. I mean, that's what we're talking about. All are welcome in this place. This is who we are. This is the Lord's table. This is the Lord God's church, not my church. So all are welcome in this place. And all he said was, okay, that's great. Next week comes around, and then he comes over all happy, right? As if he's like, said, hi, Pastor. Hey, how's it going? And she's like, I have brought my friends with me. I'm like, oh, great. How are you? So then I introduced myself. I'm Pastor Miguel, blah, blah, blah. I was like, okay, this is my friend so-and-so. He's Jewish. This is my other friend so-and-so. He's Muslim. And this is my other friend so-and-so. He's Wiccan. And he just looks at me. Right? I'm like, welcome. All are welcome in this place. I'm like, because I mean, this is the challenge, right? Of you truly being honest when you say all are welcome. But it was also a moment for us to then also appreciate and also know that we need to love people for who they are, not looking at them as project, but being honestly interested in who that person is and who Jesus has created and who God has created as this particular human being. This young man's future husband would eventually also could become a story in and of itself, because he was a recovering Catholic, that's what they call it, a recovering Catholic who had been hurt by the church, especially being gay. He had a difficult time in the Catholic Church, and he had been hurt severely by his family and by the church. And so as he was doing that, he would always, like, he would come over, he would go around the because we would get together around the altar for communion. And then I would do communion pieces to everyone. And so then, you know, the body of Christ. And of course, he would hold out his hands. He was good back. I was like, okay, great. You know, I know that you're hurt and that you don't believe. Okay, excellent. He says, yeah, I just don't believe. So I was like, no, that's fine. That's you. It's you. This is an encounter with Jesus, not me. So you do you. Until one day, I'm like, you know what? I gotta, and more than anything else, it's just to be inclusive and including everybody in the service. I said, I'm going to need you to help me with communion today. And he goes, I don't believe. Well, I didn't ask you if you believed. I'm asking you to help me serve. I said, and by serving, I mean you're going to hand this. And it's like, but I don't believe. Again, it's not about you or me. It's about the person taking it. So it doesn't matter whether you believe or not. You're going to help me serve. Well, I'm not going to do it. If you don't do it, we have no communion today. So I said, so how are we going to do it? It's like, okay, fine, I'll help. And so he helped. And so we went around, and then he would just have the cups, and he didn't even say the words. He just kind of gave him the cup, and that's it. And so that's fine. I mean, there was this participation. We wanted to include him in the participation of the feast, especially since his husband was thinking about going into ministry and all these things. And so I didn't, you know, that's another story. So in due time, however, as just by that simple invitation of participation and not taking into account that he, quote unquote, did not believe, it would be 3 months later when his husband would come to me and would say, he has proclaimed faith at home. He has proclaimed faith at home, and he says that now he believes. And I noticed it, because once we were doing that, he finally took communion, and I'm like, wait a minute. So like, okay, so am I going to burn in hell? No, just kidding. I'm like, what's going on here? So I go, okay, this is what I'm going to let it be. And like, this, because again, it's a person. It's their faith, not mine. So I'm like, okay. And that was the conviction. So then it came around to commit. Then that's when his husband said, yeah, he proclaimed that he believed. It was because you included him in this space and you challenged him in this situation that he finally has come to terms. And he's come in reconciliation with Jesus, noticing that his church was not a reflection of who Jesus is, and you have opened and provided the space for him to be loved for who he is. And so that was an amazing opportunity to see him being transformed in that way. Next slide, please. The issue, though, when we have these situations where we're actually having an open community, a community that's welcoming, a community that loves everyone, and so on and so forth, is that oftentimes you will have the exciting benefit of then having more people come, right? And that's what we want, right? We want more people to come. Just like the woman at the well goes and tells the entire town about what Jesus has done for her, so will other people begin come and begin to take part. But here's the issue. We need to be prepared for that. We need to prepare to welcome others. An example that usually a challenge, I get challenged a lot, and I have a lot of conversations around the country, especially when a well-meaning Anglo congregation wants to welcome a Latino community. They see Latinos out there. It's exciting. Yay. Well, what's the best thing? Let's have a Latino service. They have a Spanish service, right? This is great. And everything is great until all of a sudden that community outgrows the original community. Not only that, but then the community is much younger, so therefore they have children. And before you know it, we're irritated at the children. Where's the welcoming? Where is the preparing oneself? If we really are talking about welcoming others, what does this mean for us? The reality is, it's sometimes we are going to be inconvenienced, and that is okay. Because that is what being hospitable to our community is all about. It's all about us being open to the possibilities of others that have different opinions, different ways of thinking, different reflections of who God is coming into our space. Because it's not all about us, people of God. It is not about us. It is about Jesus, and it was the gospel being told and being preached that others may hear and understand what the wonderful joy it is to be in relationship with Jesus. And so we must be ready and prepared to welcome others. And how do we do that? Well, simply, if you're really interested in reaching any particular demographic, you ask the question, well, what does this mean, and what are some possibilities, what are some challenges we might face, and how do we prepare for that? How do we prepare so that we will not have to deal with it in the midst of it, but instead we can begin to prepare our people that this is our reality and this is who we are now as we are trying to transition from being just this one monocultural congregation to being a multi-ethnic, multi-generational congregation? What does this mean for us? And being able to have an open and honest conversation is to the question of, are you ready for this? And that's my challenge to oftentimes these Anglo congregations, well-intentioned Anglo congregations, that want to reach Latinos is, are you ready? Because once you open that door, or once you open that Pandora's box, guess what? God's going to work. He's going to say, okay, did you really mean it? Here we go. But then all of a sudden we want to close the box. It's too late. Things that begin to happen, you need to be ready to then move and continue to provide that space and the hospitality for those who are coming, because the Holy Spirit will act if you allow it to. The Holy Spirit is already doing its thing. It's not asking you or me permission. The question is, are we going to ride the train with the Spirit or not? That's the question. We can either ride the train with the Spirit and be like, ooh, let's jump on, let's go on this journey together, or we can be left behind. That's just the reality of who we are and where we're at, that the Spirit is active. There was once a book that was called Teología en Conjunto, Theology Together, which was a reflection of Latino theologians that were talking about. And it was ecumenical. There was a Methodist Disciples of Christ, and there was Lutherans in there as well. But one of the authors of that book, one of the contributors, in his chapter spoke about the fact that when the Spanish came to the Americas, he said, when they came to the Americas, they looked around and did not see God. What they have failed to realize is that God was there, had been there all along, and was active. Because God did not need the Spanish to give God permission to do what God's going to do. God does not need our permission to do what God's going to do. The question is, are we going to engage, and are we going to be a part of this, or are we going to be left behind in this particular journey? Next, please. I wouldn't even call it a model, but this is how I would do evangelism. This is how I engage the communities that I engage with, knowing full well that this is, again, it becomes a little natural for me to be able to talk to people and to connect to people, and it can become difficult for others, and I understand that. But there's other methodologies, there's other ways of doing it, so this is not the only one. And so here's some examples of some amazing things that's happening across the ELCA that you might want to consider for your particular congregation. For example, there is Faith Lead, Faithful Innovations out of Luther Seminary. Faithful Innovations out of Luther Seminary simply takes a congregation and a group from the congregation so that they can be like investigators of seeing what God is doing in your community. And that team goes out into the community and begins to inquire, make those inquiries on behalf of the congregation to see where God is active. One example of one of these Faithful Innovation congregations, which was an Episcopalian congregation, was that one of the things that this congregation did is that they got the team together, and as they began to reflect upon, you know, what's going on, one of the things they encourage you to do is to go out into your community and actually take your camera, and when you see something interesting, so it's a do a community neighborhood walk, you send people two by two, and you walk around. And I said, you take a picture, if you find like something unique or interesting that you have questions about, take a picture of it. And then once everybody comes back from their walk and they get together back as a team, they share what they saw. And they begin to have be inquisitive with one another. I wonder what God is doing here. In this particular congregation, one of the teams saw a nondescript, what looked like apartment complex, but it didn't have a name. It didn't have a title. It didn't have apartment so-and-so. So they were curious about that. So as they were curious about that, the next step in Faithful Innovation is then investigate. So they did. The team went to this building. They saw that they had doors that were open, so they went inside. And they asked the question, excuse me. They saw there was a reception area. What is this? Because it looks like an apartment complex, but you don't have a sign. And it's like, well, this is a HIV and AIDS home where all of our clients that live here, residents that live here, have HIV and AIDS, and they come here to die. There's a reason why we don't have a sign, and that's because there's some hateful people that would like to see this place burned down. But know that, you know, we're here and we're faithfully providing the service and people so that people may die with dignity, right? That was what they did. That moved the team to a point of saying, God, this is awesome. God is active in this place. How can we engage in this amazing work? And so what do? They go back and they say, can we do a meal? So what do you mean? It's like, we want to do a meal. It's like, well, there's been other churches that try to come in and do that, but people are kind of weary because, you know, many of the residents are from the LGBT community and they've been burned by the church. And I said, no, we just want to do one meal. And how about we do something simple that's non-religious? Let's just do Thanksgiving. Can we provide Thanksgiving meal? Fine, you can do Thanksgiving meal. So great. So that year they did a Thanksgiving dinner. The church members came. They had dinner with the community members, and they provided this amazing spread, and so they had this amazing Thanksgiving dinner. Everything was great. So then they said, can we come back next month? And then after the next month, and so on, they said, can we come back next week? And so before you know it, they were serving one meal a week at that place, and the members of the congregation were engaging in conversation and in relationship with the residents in that community. Then it got to a point where one of the members of the community said, I'd like to for us to have a church service. Could you provide a church service for us? Nah, no, just kidding. No, it's like, of course. And sure enough, they provided an Sunday afternoon service, so the pastor would do the service in the morning at the church and then come back over here to provide a chapel service for the residents of that community. And so before you knew it, this became a faith community in that residence. And the pastor would later testify that as part of that seeing that amazing engagement and that how his community had changed because of their engagement in that community, he said, we knew we had made a difference when one of the residents passed away. And then the staff of the program said that before the resident passed away, he told the staff, could you please ask Pastor so-and-so to do a service for me here for my friends in the residence? And the pastor said, nah, no, just kidding. Yes, they did. And they provided a memorial service so that the community could mourn their friend at their residence. The congregation was transformed just by simply allowing and asking questions and being able to see where God was already active. Not even starting something new. It's just jumping on board to what God is already doing. So that's Faithful Innovation. The next one is something called Fresh Expressions. I know, how many of you have heard of Fresh Expressions? Anybody here? I know Pastor Elise is here somewhere. Yes, so Pastor Elise, she was the DM in Central Illinois, and she started Fresh Expressions and that Synod. Fresh Expressions is a way of doing outreach by having a blended ecology, where you have an established congregation that gives permission for those who are really outgoing, for your lay people who are really outgoing, to go out and start new communities of faith, of interaction, of theological discussion, outside of your church. And they go out into different communities and they do affinity groups. There's where pub theology, there's where cafe church, yoga church, all these little expressions of faith begin to grow out of one congregation. And so there's different ways of doing it, and there's different reflections of doing that. But there's ways to be able to teach congregations how to be able to do this work to allow lay people to go out and start these new communities so they can begin to tell the story of Jesus out there in their community. So that's Press Expressions. The other one is Life of Faith Initiative out of Wartburg Seminary. Life of Faith Initiative out of Wartburg. It takes a look at one's own life and one's own vocation as a faithful disciple of Jesus and see how that one can faithfully engage with others through their own faith life. And then finally, we have something called the ELCA Evangelism Network that is a place that a monthly meeting that they have where you can come and hear stories and engage in the conversation around whole evangelism conversation within the ELCA. And I would encourage you to participate in that because, again, it's non-committal. You just show up, and then you are part of the conversation and the topic that's going on in that place. So those are some places where you can find some of that in the ELCA. Next. Okay. Now enough, that's enough of Miguel talking. Now it's going to be your turn. So I know that we're kind of spread out and this is not the best place to do small groups, but if you can find your people, whoever your people are, how many you are, either find a space out there or in here where you can have this conversation with four simple questions. Actually, take out your phones. I know you have your phones because you've been voting, and take a picture of the question. The questions are, where are the potential wells in your community? So talk about your particular context in your community. Where are some potential wells in your community? Who are the Samaritan women in your community? Is your congregation ready to welcome others? And actually have a really thoughtful conversation on that, a really honest conversation to see if your community is ready to welcome others. And what is one first step you will take when you return home to engage others with the good news of Jesus? So I invite you, it's 3:46 right now, I invite you, we're going to come back around 5:30, so you have 44 minutes or so. And then at that 5:30, then we're going to have some Q&A, some question and answer, and so that we can have to engage. Yes? 4:30. Oh, my gosh, what time is it? Yeah, 4:30. Yeah, not 5:30. Aha! I was testing you. No, come back at 4:30, and then we'll have, and then we'll do some Q&A, and that way you can, you know, if you want to ask me some questions or challenge me, which I'm perfectly fine with, let's do it, and let's have some deep conversation together. So with that, go. 4:30, remember, 4:30, not 5:30.
All right, friends.
Let's start coming back as we gather together once again for a large group conversation. It is my understanding that the mics that are used for during voting will be hot. So if you have a question or you want to engage in conversation, I invite you to go to one of the mics. It doesn't matter. You don't have to be pro, against, or neutral. You can go to whichever mic you want on your side and so that we can have this conversation. So I'll open it up for questions. Or actually, let me ask you a question before we do that. How was your experience in conversation? Is there anything that was eye-opening in your conversation? And if so, please walk up to the microphone and share what you talked about in your congregation within your group. I'm sorry? It was awesome? You didn't go to the mic. You're just kidding. Thankfully, I can hear you. So, yeah, that's, yeah. Excellent. Well, good. I'm glad you were able to enjoy it. Any other insight from your conversation with your fellow parishioners? How many of you had a challenge identifying your Samaritan woman? Raise your hand. Okay. For how many of you was it super easy to say, you know, this is who I know our Samaritan women are? Raise your hand. Okay. How many know exactly where your well is at? You know exactly the place where you can go. Anybody? Excellent. And then how many of you are super excited, like I am, to go back and try something new in your congregation? Raise your hand. Woo! Yay! All right. Okay. So the mics are hot. So if you want to go back there, you have any comments or you want a specific question, please do so. These lights really are horrible. I can't see, so I'm going to have to do this. So I can't see the mic. So you can just start talking. Okay? Anybody? Anybody? Bueller?
Pastor, over here, mic 3.
Oh, there you go. Yes, please.
I want to know more about the ale Bible study at uh-huh. my local bar, the watering hole. The thought occurred to me is I taught an adult Luther and Dr. or Lutheran, what's the word? Catechism. Yeah. But that might be a good thing to try in a, out in public.
Well, and here's another thing, that it doesn't have to be a pub. That's one that's very popular, especially amongst the young people. But for instance, we also used to do the same thing, especially with the young adults at coffee shops. We were at a university town, and so there was these hopping coffee shops, and we would go and put up a sign that just said, you know, we're having a discussion or whatever, and just invite people to come and join us at that time. And so, but there was a couple of times when we actually did, because there were some of the young adults that had not done catechism, and so we had catechism discussions in the coffee shop. Oh. So that was another way to be able to do that. But yes, that'd be great conversation to be had during that time.
Thanks for the ideas, and you're a great speaker.
Yeah, thank you. All right, anybody else? Middle microphone, yes.
Hello, Miguel. Good to see you again. I come from Harvard Trinity. We have a huge Spanish population.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm afraid, you know, that's where we have to go to try to build up our congregation. And how do you open that Pandora's box when you don't have the backup to be able to, you know, the fear of the Pandora's box? And I think that is our strongest place that we can go.
You have the gift in this synod of having Pastor Josh Ebner as your director for Evangelical Mission. And I say that because he actually was a pastor of a Spanish-speaking congregation and was also a bilingual community. So you have somebody who has an expert in those and how to address those issues on your synod staff. And actually, I encourage when any synod I go to, I always say, look, one of the best-kept secrets in your synod is a director for Evangelical Mission. Congregations pay thousands of dollars for consultants to come in and talk about blah, 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 right? Because the expert is always the one that comes from the outside. But the reality is you have a free director for Evangelical Mission that is there and ready to help you to exactly what you're saying, talk about those questions. The way that we address it is that we usually have a congregation is, like for instance, if a congregation is interested and wants to begin that conversation, it begins with the director for Evangelical Mission. In the case of Pastor Josh, because he is experienced and he does have, you know, the Spanish-speaking community, I would trust that he would know and be able to ask the questions of how to kind of test if your congregation is ready. For those directors of Evangelical Mission that don't have that experience, they usually call me, and we have a network within the ELCA of pastors that Latino pastors that would gladly come and have that discussion with you to say this is the issues. Like, for instance, for me, I have served two Anglo congregations with Spanish-speaking congregations. And so within them, and so addressing those issues and how to deal with that, it's something that you know, now I'm not an expert, but I can share my experience. And I know that other pastors like Pastor Ruben Duran, other pastors like Jaime Dubon, other ones within our network that would gladly come and have those conversations with you to begin to ascertain whether or not this is something that you are ready for. And most of the congregations, it takes about a year or two to actually prepare, because there's some really like serious conversations, questions that need to be asked, addressed before we even open Pandora's box. Because there's questions around, like for instance, you know, tell us about the culture of your, like you know, of your facility. Like how is it that, you know, because that's one of the biggest complaints that we receive is that all of a sudden the facility is being overused, quote unquote, right? Because now all of a sudden you have quinceañeras, and of course, Anglo congregations are no quinceañeras, but you know, with the Latino community you have hundreds of quinceañeras in the summer. And so all of a sudden, their facility is being used all the time. So how do we deal with that, or how we address that? Or how do we do cost sharing? Because now the utility bill has gone up because we're using the sanctuary. Like in Arizona, it's the winter, you guys here in the winter is where you get most of your high, is my understanding, because of the winter. In Arizona, it's the summer. And so utilities go up because the use of the air conditioning in the summer. But those are the kind of questions that they can begin to ask. So I would advise that you begin that conversation with Pastor Josh Ebner, and have him, well, he's not here right now. I think he left already to begin preparations for his mom's funeral. But when he gets back to the office, have that conversation with him. He can begin to address that with you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Microphone two. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Pastor Michaela Donlean at St. Paul in Sterling. And one of the things that we've been, and I hope I captured this for my group, but do you have any thoughts or words of wisdom on helping folks understand that welcome is not a zero-sum So if we start talking pronouns, or if we change the lyrics to Jesus loves the little children, but you sang it differently as a kid, that your history, your story is not negated because we're welcoming someone else's story. And wow, that was actually kind of profound, but it didn't work when I tried that in a different conversation. So do you have thoughts on that?
So there is pre-work that you can do, and I believe that there are some Bible studies available, especially around the issue of hospitality, that are available, where you can actually do like a simple adult forum and start doing, and this is your prep work. You begin to prep, and this is the thing that I think is most important for us to understand, is it takes, if you're going to be serious about this work, is intentionality, not haphazard, right? Because if you go haphazard, there's a lot that could go wrong, but when you're intentional, you begin to prepare your community for what is about to come, and you're realistic about it, then we can begin to ask those questions. So let me give you an example of intentionality. One of the congregations that I served was St. Peter Lutheran in Mesa, Arizona. And St. Peter, before I arrived, they were talking about starting a Spanish, this is the first ministry that I started, was San Pedro, was the Spanish side of it. And so this was not me, this was the pastor, the senior pastor of the congregation. So he had community forums to begin the conversation because they had talked about running a Spanish-speaking service. And when they began, there was discussions, and they began to actually having talks, but he was so in tune to the culture of the community that he asked a question, and he began the conversation for people to share each other's immigrant experience, right? Share each other, and everybody, of course, at least in that congregation, was uber excited about the fact that they either came from Norway, Finland, or Germany, right? And that was it. And so everybody had an amazing immigrant story, which most of the time, it was not their story, it was their great-grandparents' story. But there was still pride in that, right? And so then the pastor was very, very interestingly was able to pick at the fact that this was a place where there was going to be a connection with the community. And he said, so imagine, if you will, that instead of being Oslo, who's coming from Norway, his name is Jose. And instead of coming to the United States with $5 in their pocket and with a note that says Minnesota, instead it's somebody that's coming through Texas and it says San Antonio or Houston. And then you talk about, you know, where would that person find community when they arrived to their new place? It was the church, because that was the common place. That was where most of the time it was the Norwegian service or the Swedish service or the Finnish service. That's where they would go and they would find community. It says, now change the name. Change the name to Jose, to Miguel, to Pablo, what's the difference? And so that was a connection that he made. He was able to make that transition, but it took intentionality and weeks of conversation and preparation for them to be able to get to that point of being able to say, well, yes, and they voted unanimously to call me to do that work. But again, intentionality of being in preparation, so that's what I would encourage. There are some Bible studies out there that talk about hospitality and how do we deal with that.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Other questions? Yes.
Yeah, my name is George Sanchez. I'm from New Life in Bolingbrook.
Huh?
So I've never considered myself an evangelist, but when I married my wife, she was Lutheran. So I started going to church with her. And lo and behold, opportunities start to crop up to do God's work or whatever you want to call it. So I ended up starting with the Anti-Racism Committee long, long time ago, back in the 90s. One opportunity led to another, and I ended up serving, four or five different groups, Synod, Council, and all of that, and I've gone to so many churches in up here, and I've never looked for an opportunity to go anywhere. Opportunities presented themselves to us, and I never had the gumption to say no. I just went and experienced church.
Yeah.
And like you, I says, when you start experiencing church, other people, other pastors, other congregations, you learn a lot. You learn a lot about the church. I learned about myself. You know, right now I'm doing memorial services for veterans when they pass away. Memorial services at the National Cemetery for them. We do visitations. I visit our people that can't come to our building. I go see them. you know, somebody, one of my family asked me, why aren't you not a pastor? I said, I don't want to be a pastor. I just want to do what I do. I don't consider that evangelism. I consider that my job.
Your vocation, yeah.
But if you want to call it that, yes. I'm just being myself.
Yes. Thank you for that. There was an interesting study that was done. This is back in 2006. A Demon student at Luther Seminary was his thesis was on vocation and vocational satisfaction. How satisfied are you in your church vocation? And their in their study, what they did is they interviewed 500 people from all over the country from different congregations. And in that interview, they had a set of questions asking about how satisfied they were and so on and so forth of what they were doing. What's interesting about that particular study was that when he came and presented this at the mission conference in the Grand Canyon Synod in 2007, he gave examples, but he said he wanted to share specifically the extremes of the highest satisfied person and the lowest satisfied person in vocational, happiness on what they were doing. And so he shared that the person with the lowest score and that scored the lowest in the test said it happened to be, I said, a college professor from a small Midwest town that his vocation, especially in his church, was to teach confirmation. And so he was a confirmation teacher at his church. Says, but the problem was that when he taught confirmation, it was not about how to live the faith. It was about apologetics, how to defend the faith, right? How to have the right theology. So his entire focus was how to have the right way of thinking in order to be a good Lutheran. And that was what he was teaching young people. That person scored the lowest amount. He was not very happy in what he was doing. Said, but the person with the highest score in this test, said, happened to be a Frito-Lay truck driver. A Frito-Lay, the chips, truck driver, that he would go in his delivery routes, and his vocation was to be a prayer warrior. And so everyone on his route knew who he was because he was a prayer warrior. And so as soon as he arrived at a dock, at a shop or whatever, and he would just start delivering his stuff, all of a sudden somebody from the office would come out and say, oh, so-and-so, I need you to come in because such and such had a miscarriage and they want you to pray for them. Or the so-and-so moms died, they want you to come pray for them. And this lay person, Frito-Lay, but also not a clergy person, but a lay person, would literally, that was intended, by the way, because it was funny. If it wasn't funny, it would not be. This lay person was so, but that brought him so much satisfaction to be a prayer warrior for wherever he was at. And so by taking, again, the opportunities that were presented to him and going for it, and he was just so satisfied at being able to do this. So he didn't have to be a pastor. He could just have a regular, normal job, but still be satisfied of the fact that he was living his faith the best he could by praying for other people, right? And what an amazing witness for us to share that all of us are capable to do that. There was one of the saints in the cloud of witnesses now, but a faithful member of the last congregation that served at First Evangelical. She was 89 years old the last time I saw her before she went to meet Jesus. But she her name was Beth, and she was blind. But during her, earlier when the congregation first started, she was a Sunday school teacher. And she was a Sunday school teacher for like 40, 50 years, faithfully living out her Sunday school teaching, and she did that faithfully. But by the time she got to be 89, she was blind. She couldn't see anymore. And so I would go and visit her, and I remember one time going, it's like, oh, thank you so much, Beth, for all the wonderful years you provided for the church, doing this home visit and whatever. And she said, now it's time for you to rest and to be able to have this, let somebody else take over and so on. So it's like, Pastor, I'm not done. And I was like, you're not done. And I kind of wanted to say, you're blind. What else? I'm not sure how else to address this. Like, okay. So it's like, no. When I hear the clock, because she had one of those old-timey clocks, with the little bird that come out, right? When I hear that clock come out and marks the hour, my waking hours, when it chirps, I pray for somebody at the church. Every waking hour of her day, she would pray for somebody at the church. So he says, if an elderly blind woman can have complete knowledge of what her vocation is today, what is our excuse today? We can all provide something do something in our community to make a difference in our faith community that can make a difference in people's lives. And so that is such an amazing witness to that. So do we have somebody in microphone three?
Yes.
Yes.
My name is Thomas Mospo. I'm at Good Shepherd Lutheran in Lena. And you had expressed, you told the story about saying that being a pastor was just your day job. I'm in the opposite situation. Being a pastor is my hobby, and I have a full-time job as a computer engineer. Now, I've had a number of experiences, some in the United States, but a lot in when I was working in London, that people that I was working with knew that I had a degree in theology, but I would never actually start any of the conversations, but they would start to ask me questions. My boss, well, the big boss who ran the company, would say, "You're an intelligent person. How can you possibly believe in God?" And so this opened up huge opportunities to just to express, to explain my own faith. But it was never, what I discovered was that it never was fruitful if I tried to push anything. But I found that people who knew that this was what I thought would come to me and start asking questions that I think, so I guess my experience has been that when we try to do evangelism as pushing something, the response is usually not very good. Yeah. But when people are aware of our faith out in the world at the well, I found that they would come to me.
Yeah, thank you. So speaking of that, there was I was thinking of the fact that, where am I going with that? I just had a thought and then I lost it. Never mind. If I come up with it, I'll remember it and I'll bring it back up. Microphone two.
Hello, my name is Hector Mendoza with Bethany Lutheran in Crystal Lake. You know, when I think about our community and what all ties us together, where we all are, we're all right here online or on our phones. And I think that for a lot of our congregations and the LCA in general, our online presence is more of an afterthought than it is a priority. You know, our webpage, our website, or our Facebook page is our new front door. When somebody wants to check out our church, they want to see what we're about, that's where they go. And there's a lot of us that still have messages about COVID services on our websites.
Yeah.
But also, it kind of feels like the Wild West a little bit because we're all on different webpage services. We all have different templates that we're using for Facebook. There's no uniformity and there's really no guidance. And there's a lot of congregations that don't have the resources or tech-savvy people to update those things or to work on that. And I think it's a big opportunity that's kind of being missed out on. And as time keeps going, it continues to get missed out on. So I'm just curious if there will be guidance or there will be some type of uniformality that will be coming.
So I will say that there is, did you know that we actually have online churches now? Fully, completely online churches that don't do necessarily communion just yet, but they actually have online services. And because of that, because especially after the COVID situation, it lended itself to have more of the practicality of being able to do more online stuff in a more intentional way, as opposed to a second thought, which most of us at that time, before that, everything was second, you know, it's like, oh, well, we'll get to it when we get to it. But never really, like, let's be intentional about it. And some of these churches are now, I mean, they have engagement of 1,000 people. And you know, but it takes the knowledge and to how to do that, because I don't know what algorithms are. I don't know what that is. I don't understand those kinds of things. But, I mean, those people that have that knowledge, they're a gift. And so I encourage you to, you know, especially if a congregation that does not deal with that, that you think about, you know, how can we experiment with some of that to begin to build our online presence in a more intentional way, because you're right, it should not be, you should not be having, you know, Easter services from 2013 still on your page. That's just impossible, because then it's not valid, and if you're outdated already. So, yes, thank you. Microphone one.
Hi, my name is Deacon Laura Gordon. I serve at Christ Lutheran in Belvedere. And my question has to do around language. I was born and raised in the Lutheran Church. I went to a Lutheran college. I went to a Lutheran seminary. A majority of my friends are Lutheran clergy. My fiance did not grow up in the church, and when he did go to church, it was an Assemblies of God church. Totally different, obviously. When we first started dating, I would talk about VBS, and he's like, what the heck is VBS? I said, Vacation Bible School. What is Vacation Bible School? And I often think about how often do we, in our Lutheran circles, use language that outside of the Lutheran circle is unknown. And so do you have any resources that can talk about insider versus outsider language?
Well,
I think it's important to remember that, like, just because we in this room know what those words mean, not everybody does.
So I think that what we have addressed this topic in the past has also going back to hospitality. Because, you know, to be hospitable, you also have to be able to have language that people are able to understand, or not make the assumption that everybody knows. So I'll be honest, as you know, and now that I'm part of the system, you know, part of the, you know, the church-wide office, one of the things that's kind of problematic is that we acronyms. We have so many acronyms that unless you work for church-wide, you have no idea what anybody says. But we have the bad habit of just rattling off all these acronyms when we're in our spaces that we forget that we have others. So for instance, in our staff, we have, now we have an Episcopalian in my staff. And so he is completely learning a new language with us. And so our staff had to be really intentional. And it takes a lot of intentionality. Again, going back to the conversation of how to be intentional. And there are some, I'm trying to remember who it is. There are some organizations that will actually take you through an exercise, which they will look at your bulletins or your any kind of like all your publishings and your media posts to actually begin to identify those places where there's like, this is clear to you, but it's not clear to somebody else. If I can remember, I will try to send it to Josh so he can send that resource. But I don't remember who it was that does that kind of work, but there is somebody that can help you be able to identify those sections where you can say, well, this is, but the main topic is hospitality. That's what it comes down to, because we do want everybody to be able to be accessible to what you're trying to say and do.
Yeah, thank you.
You're welcome. Any other microphone? Microphone three.
Hi, Joanna Patterson. I'm a pastor at Faith in South Beloit. And I'm a possibilities girl. I really like all of the 15 bajillion options that my ADHD brain can come up with in 30 seconds. My problem is that I see wells everywhere.
Mm.
And I don't think any of us have that much time. And also, to try and find a well where we have enough cred to actually sit down and listen is a big part of the hurdle for me. To like actually have a real conversation without agenda, to hear who and what the other person brings to the conversation, even without our own, like, well, this is what I would love. 'Cause I think and I don't even think it's necessarily conscious, but our own desperate need for butts in the pews and support of the system seeps into everything we try to do.
Yeah.
So my question, I'm getting there, I promise.
So what are you getting at? That's what.
Right. Finding a well that I can honestly sit down and listen at without agenda. Mm-hmm. How do we discern which wells we might be able to approach with integrity and respect and not our neediness?
Right. So there's two things that I can advise. Number one, talk to your director for Evangelical Mission. That it's their job. That is what they're intended to do. They're supposed to help you do missional planning, and that's one way of doing it. The second one would be talk to, see if you can do team coaching with your particular team. Like one of the coaching questions that I would ask, like for instance, is what are your low-hanging fruit? Or even doing a SWOT analysis, a strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats that are happening within your community, and then make those determinations out of all that and begin to match up the low-hanging fruit with some of those to see if there's something that has the best possible way of actually surviving. And so that's the way that I would do it. So I would say you talk to first to your director for Evangelical Mission, Pastor Josh, and to have that missional conversation. And then he might be able to appoint somebody or actually ask somebody to do some team coaching with you all, your congregation, to see how you can be able to work that out yourselves as you're preparing to do something, to start something. So I guess my time is up. I see Bishop looking at me. She's staring at me, and it's burning me. So that means I better stop. So thank you so much. I'll be around till tomorrow. So thanks.
Pastor Beamsley said, "Can you slink up to the podium and give him a cue?" So I slinked up to the podium. Thank you, Pastor Miguel. Pastor Beamsley, you need to slink up to your podium. Pastor Miguel will be with us again tomorrow to give the churchwide report. While Pastor Jennifer walks across the stage, I'm just going to say and affirm what Joanna Patterson said. Pastor Patterson said, "My problem is I see wells everywhere." We all see wells everywhere. Those opportunities are everywhere. We are surrounded by those moments where we are in the place where the mundane of life is happening and the holiness breaks in. It is a problem and an opportunity and a gift and an overwhelming time for discernment for all of us. So Pastor Miguel mentioned the coaching network. We can connect you with some of those and some of the other discernment possibilities. The wells are everywhere. Pastor Beamsley.
Bishop Fidler.
Will you give us the second best announcements ever given?
Sure.
Since you gave us the best ones ever given this morning.
Oh, wonderful. Good evening, Assembly. How are you? I feel like you're going to hear from me every time you get nourishment. So you're going to be like little Pavlov dogs, where every time you see me, you'll be like, "We're excited for whatever she has to say." We are going to dinner next, and we ended our schedule about 15 minutes ahead of time, but the buses are ready to go. So you are in Centennial Hall, for those of you who have not been on the Augustana campus. But our meal is up in the Gerber Center, which is on the other end of campus, and there are two ways to get there. You could walk. It's gorgeous out. If you want to, you can cross the street. Watch for traffic. Please go in the crosswalks, and I'm not kidding, because people will be able to know where you're at. And then you can kind of take the middle sidewalk there. You're going to head to what looks like the library.
It's a big building that says library.
Head there. I am gonna give you a little hint, though. If you're a person who's like, "I hate stairs," don't go that way. Don't go that way. Or hills.
The library has an elevator.
Well, it does, but you have to get up. You have to first, remember, you have to go up all the stairs.
Oh, you have to go up the stairs first.
Okay, so here's another way you could go. We have school buses. I know. I want to see. When we were back in the back, people said they clap for everything. I wanted to just try it out. Okay, so these, school buses. So these school buses are right outside Centennial Hall. I know you want them. Here's the great thing about these buses. They will take you to the Gerber Center where your meal is at. So unlike school, this is high motivation to get on the bus, right? Food awaits you. Get on the buses that'll take you up to the Gerber Center, and then you'll enter it. They'll drop you right off there. You'll turn left. There is the dining hall that you get to be in. And then afterwards, we're going to have a ministry fair, all right? So then that's in the lower left. That's the floor down, and there are elevators. So if you come out of the cafeteria, turn to the right, there's an elevator there. It'll take you to the next floor, to Yavla Hall. That is where we're going to have our ministry fair. So excited for this. Let me tell you the times for this, though. Dinner is going to be served from 5:30 to 6:30. And then the ministry fair is from 6:30 to 8 p.m. And we're going to have a special ceremony, like, to recognize and celebrate with joy some of the people who are hitting, like, milestones in their life together, in their ministry, both as congregations and as individuals. So I hope that you come and see how the story of God is woven all throughout the ministry of our synod. And then at 7 p.m., that's the time when we're going to mark that milestone for so many people. There's also dessert there, and there's displays from all the ministries of our synod. I want to tell just a quick story about last year. We had worship, and then I was supposed to do announcements, but then we started playing the prelude right away, and I hadn't told anybody about the buses. So we knew half the assembly had no idea how they were going to get up to dinner. And this is what I love about Lutherans. So I run up the side aisle to think, oh my gosh, people have to tell them what to do next. And I get outside, and there's a whole bunch of people going, what do we do next? I don't know. Here's some buses. Let's get on those. The whole assembly got onto buses. They had no idea where they were going, if they were for them. I'm a Lutheran because of the high sense of trust we have of one another, that a simple school bus will take us to where we need to go. There are some of you who will want to stop at the, and I kid you not, this is what it's called, the Wild Thyme Station in the dining hall. That's where the special meals are, or if you are avoiding certain allergy foods, that's where you want to go. And then also, Augustana has made a concerted effort to make sure that you know what are the ingredients in these foods so that you can eat in a way that is healthy for your body. Okay, we talked about that. I also want to let you know that this loop, the buses are going to go up there. They're going to come down. There's no parking up there, so please take the buses between 5:30 and 8:30. And then once you get back down here after you have had your dinner and the ministry fair, the golf carts are available to take you to your cars in the parking lot. Let's give a shout-out to our host congregation this year, Salem Lutheran Church Moline, who is driving us around and taking care of us. Okay, let's talk about tomorrow. Tomorrow we're going to be gathering here again at 8:30, and we're going to begin with a morning worship service, our service of lament and healing. And then our second plenary starts right after that. Please do remember to bring your voting device, your phone or your tablet or laptop. We're going to be hearing results from our general ballot. We're going to be voting together on how our generosity funds our ministry. We're going to discern our resolutions together. If you're not able to be with us, you can simply leave your tag over there on the registration table. We'll reuse them again. You have done very good and holy work, people of God. We are so grateful that you are here, and we are looking forward to dinner. Bishop. That concludes my announcements. Would you pray us into our next?
I will pray us into our, but I want to take a picture of everybody waving.
The buses will bring you back. The buses will take you there, Janice. They will bring you back. The golf carts will drive you to your car. You will be able to go home and rest and come back for more. Excellent.
Absolutely. And the other thing, yes, the bus will take you there, the bus will take you back, the golf carts will be here, we are caring for your every need, but here's the deal, you don't get dessert unless you go to the ministry fair. You gotta go downstairs, that's where all the sugar, the good Augustana cookies and other assorted things are. Also, I don't know if Jennifer Prinz is here, but Portico, they have great pens.
Oh!
Yes. Yes?
I have another announcement.
Out of your pocket it comes?
Yeah. I wanted to also remind
check
you.
Check out the tables.
Yeah, check out the tables, and especially the diaconia table. They are also holding a sweepstakes, $90 value for one lucky winner. Stop, this was written for me, stop. At the display table tonight, sign up. Winner will be announced on Saturday.
Okay, we don't know what they win.
Oh, wait, that might be the first line. Hang on. Oh, we are again. We are again. Oh, it's a free diaconia class.
Should we pray and go eat?
We shall.
Why don't you stand?
Do it.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Good and gracious God, for each hand that has brought together this meal, for each heart that has dreamed of how to care for the people here, for each mind that has thought through all the logistics, for all the people of God gathered here, and for the many ways you have provided for us, we give you thanks. Bless all of those who walk with us tonight in serving and in caring, and keep us safe in this night ahead. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Go in peace. Find a bus.